Glad to see someone's ready, because you're caught in the SF Vortex.
Yikes.
It's not that bad, but I get the feeling that some of the names in Mars' attacks aren't as big as they seem. Could the aliens finally win?
We will never, never surrender!
It's a futuristic fight for survival in the TV movie The Cold Equation, where there's only room for one.
What we call a fundamental design constraint. We could die out here.
And what do you say we check out the slime they're finding on Voyager this week?
I'd say we've got an unexpected guest.
No, everyone's invited, so how about we just get to the business at hand and preview and review the world of sci-fi entertainment.
This is tremendously exciting. Think of it, the knowledge, the new ideas, it's going to change everything.
Roger Lodge, and this is another edition of SF Vortex. You know us. We're the show that brings you all the latest in science fiction entertainment. Think of us as your SF hotline, if you will, except we don't charge you $3.99 per minute, and you don't need anybody's permission to watch. However, what you should do is what one of our faithful viewers, Dwayne Clark, did. He emailed us, okay? He wrote, "I've been a faithful viewer since I've stumbled across your show. I've been passing the word on to my friends to watch the show, too." Thanks, Dwayne. As long as you continue to watch, we'll keep bringing you sneak previews and colorful debate. And for those of you who want to know who our War Room guests are today, it's our friends from Babylon 5. That's right, they're back in a big way. Bruce Boxleitner, Jerry Doyle, and producer John Copeland are here to talk about their sci-fi favorites. But before we head down to the War Room, let's preview, shall we? Starting, of course, with Mars Attacks, which invades theaters next weekend and has pretty much been the talk of the town. Director Tim Burton has had some of Hollywood's biggest names clamoring to be in his 50s sci-fi spoof. And here's what the celebs had to say about working in Martian Mayhem.
What do you think, Marcia?
And what was fun is that every day you'd hear that somebody else had joined the cast.
My first day's work was in the Oval Office. First day, a six-page scene. There was Jack, the man, as the president. There was Glenn Close, the first lady. Natalie Portman, young, beautiful Natalie Portman. Mr. Rod Steiger, Martin Short, and yours truly. This is tremendously exciting.
Think how strong we would be. Earth and Mars together.
Jack Nicholson as president? Burton couldn't have chosen a better actor to go up against the Martian.
Yikes.
And I asked him, so Jack, you know, which part would you do a part? He goes, I'll do them all. It was so great.
Nicholson doubles up as a slick Las Vegas real estate hustler, Art Land.
The Martians land on Earth. They don't need a place to stay, just like everybody else.
We're being chased by the Martians, and we're running across, and there's explosions and trees blowing up, and, you know, the sky's lit up, and there's spaceships flying all around us. I mean, when you get a chance to do stuff like that? That's like, you run down there and do that, baby.
For as many stars that are in Mars Attacks, there are countless more three-foot visitors from the angry red planet.
And we'll never surrender!
Made a real conscious effort to not have them, to not understand them, not put subtitles under them, not give them, you know, human voices.
Now we're passing through here. One of the film's most memorable characters is the Martian girl.
very graceful. I like that.
When you're a teenager, you know, those science fiction films help with your hormones as well, you know, when you feel like kind of outcast and you see these, like, sci-fi girls, you know, they kind of get you going, you know.
One scene was lifted straight from card number 76, which featured the buxom blonde vixen lifting her disguise to reveal a bulging green brain and bloodshot eyes.
There's a lot about them we don't know. Yeah, that's what I liked about these Martians. It's like nothing is quite as it seems, and that somehow on many levels it's somewhat of a theme of things I like to do.
Whoa!
Oops, sorry, Ashley. Just shrunk the camera guy. Pretty hard to come by. Oh, by the way, can somebody get Mr. Burton a comb? I can make a little fun. He's a good friend of mine. Anyway, let's move on. By now, most of you have seen Star Trek First Contact, right? If not, what the heck are you waiting for, folks? Get out and see it. Actually, 90.4% of you who voted in our War Room webpage gave the 8th Star Trek movie a huge... That's right. Which is quite a contrast to what our War Room panelists said last week, remember, as they pretty much ripped it apart. But Carl Riley, one of our faithful viewers, emailed, lighten up, get into the spirit of the movie instead of tearing it apart. First Contact, time travel or not, was one of the best of the Trek movies. Hey, Carl, I'm with you, babe. All right, let's move on. There's another big premiere next weekend you don't want to miss. You don't even have to wait in line for it, folks. Don't have to wait in line for it because it's right here on your favorite channel, the Sci-Fi Channel. The Cold Equations is based on a short story by Tom Godwin. The star is Bill Campbell, you know him from Rocketeer. Well, old Billy Boy finds himself in a life or death situation.
So what are you going to do?
Ask for help.
Don't be stupid. They're not going to help. You're kind of stuck with me.
Stupid? I'm stupid. You have no idea what's happening.
Yes, I do. I'm here, and it's against the rules. And don't be such a pain. I said I'd pay the fine.
There is no fine. It's more serious than that.
Look, I'm not scared of you. You think I care about your orders? I'm NC, cargo. Nothing is worse than that.
What are you doing here?
You're kidding, right? I mean, I saw you on the ship, so I know you saw where I had to live. Do I need more of a reason to get out of there?
Yeah, you do. I'm going to LC-10. It's a mining colony. Worst pit on the frontier. Nobody wants to go.
Yeah? Well, I do.
Why?
My brother's there. I gotta see him.
Well, prepare to be disappointed. We're not going.
Wait, what do you mean, not going?
Just what I said. This ship can't go to LC-10 with you on board.
What, they won't let us land?
No, we can't land. Your weight wasn't figured in when we launched. If we try to land, we'll run out of fuel and burn up in the atmosphere.
I am not going back.
You can't go back. We don't have the fuel. It's what we call a fundamental design constraint. We could die out here.
In order to make the normal adjustments, he is ordered to throw the girl off. Wow. The Cold Equations debuts next Saturday night at 8 p.m. Eastern and Sunday evening at 5. Make sure you send us your comments, folks. We'd love to know what you think about that. All right. And since we have you in the mood for a little home theater, check out the latest in-home video. And no, I'm not talking about ID4. I think we've all heard enough about that one. I'm talking about my son Brandon's favorite, Dragonheart. It stars Dennis Quaid and Sean Connery as the voice of the fearless dragon.
Haven't you noticed the pickings are rather slim these days?
I got me one just the other day.
So it was you who killed the scarred one. She and I were the last. Must have been a proud kill, warrior. How much gold did a tattered carcass put in your purse?
That's none of your business.
Couldn't have been very much. And you'll kill me for sport? And when there are no more dragons to slay, how will you make a living, knight?
Shut up!
Ow. That just hurt looking at it, didn't it, guys? All right, the moral of this story, never tick something off that's at 100 times bigger than you and breathes fire. This is definitely a fantasy movie for the whole family. And by the way, Draco the Dragon was created by the same guys who brought to life those dinosaurs in a movie you might have heard of Jurassic Park. And don't go away, folks. Joining us later in the War Room, it's Babylon 5's Bruce Boxleitner, Jerry Doyle, and producer extraordinaire John Copeland.
Guys, RPP 10 o'clock.
Coming up next, previews, and more previews. Sliders is thrown into a land ruled by robots. And find out what mess Janeway's in this week when SF Vortex returns.
This Sci-Fi Channel program is brought to you by Tickle Me Elmo. Tickle Elmo and he shakes with laughter. From Tyco.
All right, welcome back to the show that brought Pamela and Tommy Lee back together. We're SF Vortex. All right, this week on Sliders, the group finds themselves in a dimension where human beings have been replaced by robots.
You should have told us that Erica was this badly damaged. I'm not sure that I can fix her.
I'm not an engineering unit. I tried but wasn't able to rewire her power supply. If you can't, she will be permanently inactive.
Don't worry, Derek. The professor's good at this. If it's possible, he can do it.
Yes. If it's possible.
What you're doing there will not work.
Please. I think I can make it work.
But your pattern of wire relays is not consistent.
It's called improvising. Circuits are so badly burned, the only way to repower her is to work around the damaged areas.
Will improvising work?
I don't know. But if you would shut up, I could finish the job and then we could both find out.
Boy, the best thing about this episode, besides Derek's red pantsuit, is guest star Robert Englund, who plays the creator of the machines. And guess what? Mr. Englund is trying to rearrange his very busy schedule so he can slide right into our war room right here next week. Eh? Okay, just about the only other show that's not in reruns yet is one of my favorites, Voyager. Now, a macro virus overwhelms the crew and disables the entire ship, and as always, Janeway must try to figure out how to save the day.
Over here. Something just punched right through this floor panel into the jet freeze tubes.
What is it?
Some sort of mucilaginous compound. High concentrations of amino acids, proteins, and fragments of non-humanoid DNA. Well, Ambassador, I'd say we've got an unexpected guest.
Somehow I don't think he's the diplomatic type.
Actually, that looked a lot like the lunch special here in the SF Vortex cafeteria. You know, the movie got a lot of us thinking about Voyager's journey home. In fact, Matt Moss emailed us with his thoughts. The Borg are from the Delta Quadrant. Won't Voyager have to go through them to reach the Alpha Quadrant? If this is so, how come there hasn't been any mention of it on the show? Well, if you thought you saw the last of the Borg, you're wrong. And here's the scoop. Come on a little closer. The Borg will encounter the starship Voyager in February. That's right, folks. You heard it right here on SF Vortex first. Hey, we're better than hard copy, huh? All right. SF Vortex is far from being over. The War Room is next with B5's crew, actors Bruce Boxleitner, Jerry Doyle, and producer extraordinaire John Copeland. Don't even think about touching that dial. All right, welcome back to SF Vortex, everybody. We are in the War Room, and joining me today is Bruce Boxleitner. He, of course, stars as Babylon 5's Captain John Sheridan. Also, John Copeland is here. He's the producer of Babylon 5. And Jerry Doyle, who plays Security Chief Michael Garibaldi. Guys, thank you so much joining us, taking time out of your busy schedule. Let me get to my first question. Jerry Doyle?
Yes.
Favorite sci-fi project of all time, go.
My Dreamy Genie?
Yes. Big Barbara Feldon fan?
Yeah.
No, big. Barbara Eden.
Yeah,
Barbara Eden.
Jerry Doyle. Barbara Eden.
Wow. Bruce Boxleitner, favorite sci-fi project of all time?
Aside from a film I did called Tron.
which was terrific.
Star Wars. The Star Wars saga.
Why?
John.
Why not? That's true.
And the whole
no, in short, in short, in short, George Lucas created a universe that at once was very familiar to, especially the film buffs. I mean, you had sort of Western, you had knights in armor, magic, and all kinds of things, plus spaceships. And he brought that all together in a great creative mix and created something that's very believable, and it never happened.
John Copeland, your favorite sci-fi project of all time?
Alien.
Real quick, why?
Because it had it was more than just a science fiction. There was tension, there was drama, it was a horror, it was
kind of a horror story.
Flick. Yeah, so kind of a horror flick. It was also a very used and dripping, you know, spaceship. It was, mm-hmm. you know, it was unlike we had seen, you know, space and spacecraft depicted before, even though that, you know, Lucas gave us the used look of space.
Used space. Yeah.
This was more like the recycled look of space.
I have to throw in one also, Blade Runner.
Oh, Blade Runner.
I think that's influenced our show a great deal.
Yeah,
Alien, Blade Runner.
Definitely has.
Our show has got some darkness to it, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
And
our universe is not a safe place to live
right.
in. The Star Wars universe, or not Star Wars, but the Star Trek universe is a place that has a utopian society on Earth. You have the Federation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the future is kind of assured for mankind. We haven't gotten there yet in Babylon 5, and I think that's part of
the
attraction.
We can't go home. We can't trust anybody that's back home.
All right, how about this?
Uh-huh.
Bruce,
yes.
Worst sci-fi project you ever saw?
Barbarella.
Ah, yeah.
There you go. How about that? Right off the top of my head. And I love Jane Fonda.
That didn't take any time at all to get
no,
to that
No, no. I mean, that was pretty worst? Silly. I saw it on Turner the other night on TNT or something. I laughed. I said, and we actually bought this stuff when it came out.
Well, it was Roger Vadim, though.
Hmm?
It was Roger Vadim.
That's true.
Or Vadim.
That's true. That's true.
I
think that's what, you know, people in the past always complain about, that, you know, science fiction movies and television were kind of schlocky, you know.
Yes.
I think the current crop, Star Trek's, you know, Next Generation, all of them. I think there's, we were talking earlier before we went on camera, you know, the technology has changed today. It's enabled us to do much more creative things, more believable things.
I think the storytelling has become more mature.
Yeah.
Rather than being just a swashbuckling, you know, story in space, we're dealing with real dramatic issues and you know, dramatic situations that the characters are in that resonate a lot closer to real life.
Yeah,
than what, you know, let's say John Carter on Mars or something like that.
Go ahead, Bruce. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, like the Western genre, the science fiction genre, you can comment on themes that affect us today. Without slapping us on the head with that exact picture of today, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You can dress it up and comment on it, and I think that's the enduring popularity of those things.
Jerry, you've been a little quiet over there.
I was just listening.
Welcome back
with
it.
Siskel and Ebert
show,
here.
Jerry,
I was listening to Bruce. I was just dozing off.
How about your worst sci-fi show?
Worst sci-fi.
Worst thing you ever saw.
I can't even think of one.
Mr. Ed.
All right.
Mr. Ed? No, that was true.
Let me ask you this, make-believe.
Jerry, let me ask you this.
Don't burst my bubble. Next thing you're going to tell me there's no Santa Claus.
Yeah, right.
Before you started on Babylon 5, were you indeed a big fan of the whole sci-fi genre?
No, never saw any of it.
Really?
Nope.
What interested you in this project?
How much they offered? No.
Money.
Oh, look at you. I'm a purist. I have nothing to do with my bruises. I do it for free. I just love the genre.
I don't need to work.
No. I like the character. I like my character. I thought he was like kind of gritty, on edge. He had a lot of things going wrong with him, recovering alcoholic relationship problems. You know, so outside of typecasting.
They got the right guy.
All right. Now, Bruce, I got about 30 seconds left. Were you a big sci-fi fan when you started this whole thing?
No, not really. I had been doing detective shows, westerns, things like that, but we have, that's all in Babylon 5 also.
Right.
You know? So, and I had only seen the show a couple times prior to joining the cast.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have an inkling that I would ever be doing it, you know?
Well, there you go.
Surprise, surprise.
Right. Here you are in the green.
Here I am in the
war room.
In the war room.
War room where it all happens, Jerry. Come on, get it straight. I want to thank Bruce Boxleitner, Jared Oyl, and John Copeland for joining us. Don't go away, folks. SF Vortex returns in just a moment.
The Pathfinder on its way to Mars. Did you see that? Are we the best thing to hit cable or what? You're not going to see that anywhere else, only here on SF Vortex. All right, lots of email again this week. Some of it sparked by Stan Lee's appearance in the War Room. Beth Chasen writes in, I heard about a year ago that a movie about the Fantastic Four was due out. Do you know when it may be coming out? Don't hold your breath on that one, Beth. That was not even in production yet. However, Chris Columbus is said to be the producer-director. On a sad note, last weekend, we lost a longtime friend in the science fiction universe, actor Mark Leonard.
Forgive me, my old friend, but I must use all my experience now to get home.
Leonard had numerous roles on stage, television, and in film. Remember the Romulan he played in the classic Trek episode, Balance of Terror? And, of course, the Klingon in Star Trek The Motion Picture. But certainly he will be best remembered as Ambassador Sarek, Spock's father on Star Trek. His sci-fi legacy, Leonard is the only man ever to play a Vulcan, a Romulan, and a Klingon. Thank you, Mr. Leonard. All right, that's it for today's episode of SF Vortex. Be sure to watch us next week. Until then, I'm Roger Lodge. Goodbye, everybody.